result of our ongoing efforts as it relates to criminal activity on the island of Grand Isle, you will recall that we began undercover operations back in July of 2014. We were able to infiltrate the island with undercover agents, which is not a simple task. The island is kind of the end of the world, one way on, one way off. Everybody knows everybody. Everyone's related to everybody. This office has spent an inordinate amount of time over the past 3 years in dealing with trying to infiltrate the community of Grand Isle at the request of Grand Isle residents and Grand Isle elected officials who have consistently and repeatedly exhibited just complete exacerbation and exasperation as it relates to the criminal activities on the island. The Detective Bureau, specifically the Special Investigations Bureau, myself and others had worked out a strategy over the past 3 years to infiltrate the island. We've had a couple of speed bumps and some hiccups over the past 3 years in trying to maintain the sanctity and the safety of our undercover agents. And it's been a very difficult process. And today we announce the culmination of the third phase of this investigation with a significant number of arrests of individuals who are best characterized as some of them, approximately three or four, as being the primary distributors of methamphetamine on Grand Isle. They're not from Grand Isle, but they're bringing it down there. They're working in concert with people from Grand Isle as it relates to the distribution of drugs on the island. Prior to and during the course of the investigation, we were made aware of a lot of improprieties within the Grand Isle Police Department. We began to collect information relative to that, not only from citizens of Grand Isle, but from arrested defendants of Grand Isle who describe strange things occurring as it relates to their arrest and things of that nature. As a result of that, working with the Mr. Connick's office, the Jefferson Parish District Attorney's office, we decided to have search warrants issued for the Grand Isle Police Department. And we ran those warrants yesterday. So we made, four people still wanted on the list, a total of 16, as I recall, four still at large that we're looking for. So we certainly asked the public for their help in locating these individuals, and their names will be provided to you. And as I said, we ran the warrants on the Grand Isle Police Department. And just in a very brief period of time, you know, we're beginning to uncover some things that are problematic, that run contrary to good safekeeping and safeguards and internal controls as it relates to money, as it relates to evidence. We have issues of commingling of private property with evidence in the evidence room, not only by members of the Grand Isle Police Department, but by the chief himself. We have situations of evidence bags that have marijuana in them, or had marijuana in them, that were tested by our lab. We would cut the bag open here when it's brought to us. We reseal it with our JPSO tape. And this is how we find the evidence bag. There's no destruction order issued by the court, but the marijuana's gone. In this particular bag, I think this one here, 87 grams of marijuana were in this bag. You can see where the bag was ripped open, and the marijuana's gone. We seized computers. We seized evidence bags going back to the 90s that were there. And we're trying to reconcile that to what purports to be an evidence log and things of that nature. We seized this gun from Chief Dubois' desk and asked him whose gun this was. I don't know. Where did the gun come from? I don't know. Who does the gun belong to? I don't know. We have a situation of PPI money, otherwise referred to as purchase of evidence, purchase of information, that requires segregated fund, requires segregated accounting, requires a lot of paperwork in the utilization of PPI money that actually was derived out of a grant and a task force. And the best that we can determine at the present time, there's $4,000 missing from the cash box. And the chief described that he used to keep the keys to the cash box in his barbecue pit, and everybody knew that the keys were in the barbecue pit. When we first got there, he could not find the keys, and subsequently notified this office that he found the keys in his office. But we've yet to find the money. So these are just a few examples of what's been uncovered. Some of this has been described to us, some of it not, that we've just, you know, have found in the very brief period of time that we've been looking at these situations. Obviously, this concerns the district attorney's office and concerns this office, as well as other players within the criminal justice system, that this is just not the way that your business is to be conducted by a law enforcement office, certainly not by a legitimate law enforcement office, as it relates to all of these particular issues.